Hello friends, welcome back to another episode by Engineering Today. In an exciting development, SpaceX's Starship briefly surpasses all other active rockets in the world in terms of power. Let's take a look at this news. In order to become the most potent operational rocket in the world, a SpaceX Starship booster successfully fired up 14 of its 33 Raptor engines. Only 3 of 4 previous rockets have ever achieved a thrust level comparable to or greater than what Super Heavy Booster 7, B7, did on November 14. However, the Saturn V and Space Shuttle of the US, the Energia and N1 of the Soviet Union, and all other rockets were retired a few decades or more ago. Only SpaceX's Falcon Heavy rocket, 5th in the group and capable of producing up to 2,325 tons, that's 5.13 million pounds of thrust at sea level, still operational and comes close. Super Heavy was capable of producing up to 3,220 tons of thrust, 7.1 million pounds, when it ignited 14 of its 33 upgraded Raptor 2 engines. SpaceX claims these engines can each produce up to 230 tons, 510,000 pound force of thrust. By placing itself above NASA's Space Shuttle, but below the Soviet Energia, Starship is now probably the 4th most powerful rocket to have ever been tested. In addition, even if none of the 14 engines were ever throttled above 73%, SpaceX's Starship booster still likely produced more thrust than any other active rocket in the world, surpassing Falcon Heavy. The title, however, might only be held by Starship for a matter of 36 hours, as NASA has its way. But even as SLS seems set to almost immediately overtake Starship's position as the most potent active rocket in the world, Starship is set to surpass SLS and become the most potent rocket ever flown when it attempts its first orbital launch either next month or at the beginning of next year. Starship can generate about 7,600 tons, 16.7 million pounds of thrust at liftoff, with all 33 Raptors running at full power, breaking the previous record held by the Soviet N1 rocket by almost 60%. Starship and SLS are currently both essential components of NASA's Artemis program, therefore this embarrassing uproar should be decreased. SLS and Orion spacecraft will carry NASA people to a lunar orbit while they'll board a moon lander built from Starship, bringing astronauts back to the moon for the first time since 1972. After landing those personnel on the lunar surface, Starship will support about a week of surface activities before returning them to lunar orbit, where Orion will then fly them back to Earth. There's still a significant amount of work to be done before NASA and SpaceX are prepared to support that crewed moon landing. However, the Starship static fire on Monday and the SLS launch on Wednesday both signify significant concrete steps in the direction of the challenging objective. Let's take a look at another interesting update. As the SLS lifts off with the Artemis 1 mission, let's move on to our next update. On November 16th, NASA's Space Launch System launched for the first time after years of delays, sending an unmanned Orion spacecraft on a moon shakedown flight. At 1:41 a.m. Eastern, the SLS launched from Launch Complex 39B here. 8.5 minutes after launch, the rocket's upper stage, known as the Interim Cryogenic Propulsion Stage, ICPS, separated from the core stage. Nearly 2 hours after launch, the stage finished a translunar injection burn, at which point the Orion spacecraft disengaged from the ICPS. Mike Serafin, the mission manager of NASA Artemis, said during a post-launch briefing, "We have a priority one mission in play right now." He also added, saying, "We had the rocket do its job and deliver the spacecraft to the point of translunar injection." He was talking about how the successful launch was made possible for the mission's primary priority, the Orion space capsule's re-entry at lunar speeds, to occur. With the exception of a few funnies or minor glitches, The Orion spacecraft was functioning exactly as we anticipated, he stated. This included a bug with a star tracker on the spacecraft, with micro-switches and a solar array that initially gave no indication that it had locked into position, as predicted, when the array deployed, but later did so. After resolving two problems during the countdown, the launch occurred more than 40 minutes into a two-hour window. NASA reported a leak in a valve in ground equipment used to refuel the liquid hydrogen tank for the core stage a little over 3 hours before the start of the launch window. A small red crew was sent by the launch director to the launch pad to tighten bolts in the valve, stopping the leak. As per Mike Bolger, Exploration Ground Systems Program Manager, at a post-launch briefing, "Our most likely case here was that we just had some loose nuts on those valves. We sent the team out and they did a terrific job, and we got the issue resolved." Two failed attempts in late August and early September were followed by the successful launch. The first, scheduled for August 29, was canceled because sensors indicated one of the four RS-25 core stage engines had not properly cooled down, a problem that was later attributed to a faulty sensor. After discovering a hydrogen leak while fueling the core stage, NASA scrubbed the second, scheduled for September 3rd. After a successful test on September 21st, NASA changed tanking procedures and replaced the damaged seals in the liquid hydrogen line. However, Hurricane Ian compelled NASA to send the SLS back to the security of the Vehicle Assembly Building before making another attempt in a launch window that closed in early October. However, those earlier launch cancellations were only minor setbacks for a launch vehicle whose development experienced lengthy delays. The SLS was required to be completed by the end of 2016 by the 2010 NASA Authorization Act, which gave NASA the order to create the vehicle. The launch of the vehicle has been steadily delayed due to a number of technical problems, primarily with the rocket's core stage. The Orion spacecraft will travel to the Moon and enter a faraway retrograde orbit there as part of the Artemis 1 mission. Orion will continue in that orbit for 5 days, traveling up to 480,500 kilometers from Earth. At 12:40 p.m. Eastern on December 11th, it will then leave the orbit and come back to Earth, splashing down off the coast of San Diego, California. Emily Nelson, NASA Chief Flight Director, in a November 14th interview, said, "We did proofs of concept early on to demonstrate that you can fit all the objects the program has decided they want us to accomplish into the shortest class mission. But it's much more of a Tetris puzzle to make sure all those things fit in." Artemis 1 is intended to test the Orion spacecraft in cislunar space, including testing the heat shield when re-entering at lunar return velocities. Artemis 2, the first crewed Orion mission, will launch after no earlier than 2024. Thanks for watching. Please subscribe for more videos like this. Hit the like button if you find the video interesting. And kindly provide your valuable feedback in the comment section. This will help us to improve.